Have you ever wanted to export images from Godot? Maybe save a PNG file from a shader? Or maybe take a transparent screenshot of your game? By using this feature and the magic of Subviewports, you can do all of that, and even make some other cool effects. So let's take a look at that. Let's start with a simple example. We'll drag in the Godot icon to create a sprite 2D node, and create a new node for our script to live in. We'll call this image exporter, and add a script to it. First, we'll create an export variable named sprite to hold a reference for the image we'll be saving. Save the file and drag the icon node into the sprite slot. Then, inside the ready function, to save the image file, we need to access the image data. This is not the texture inside the sprite 2D, but the image data inside it. And we can get that by using the getImage function. And then call the savePNG and pass in the file name we want to save. You can also save it as other formats, such as JPEG, WebP, or EXR. If we play the game now, when we close it and return back to Godot, our new image gets imported, which is the same one as before, although now it's a PNG. But still, not very useful. Before we start making something more useful, let's improve this code. Let's say we want to save this image inside a folder, output/image.png. If the folder doesn't exist, the image won't get saved. So let's make sure it is created first. We can take the directory path by calling the path.getBaseDir and check if it exists by using the dirAccess.dirExistAbsolute. And if it doesn't exist, we can create a directory with dirAccess.makeDirRecursiveAbsolute, and this will create the whole chain of directories needed for our path. Then we just need to use the path variable to save the image. And now, running the game will put the image inside the newly created output directory. But let's see how we can make this feature more useful. We'll copy our node, and take it with us into a new scene, and set that one as the main scene. Now, this scene just has some planets, but they are being affected by our world environment. Here's what it originally looked like. But by setting the background mode to canvas, changing the tone map, adding some glow, and a bit of color adjustments, we get our shinier planets. But let's say we want to save this screen as an image, keeping the transparent background. Well, back to our code. I have extracted the directory creation code to its own function, and changed a bit how the path variable works. So now we just need to add the image name, and it will have that same path. To save our image, we need to learn how Godot works. One interesting thing about it is that everything works inside viewports, and viewports have textures. So let's remove this line for now, as we don't want to save the sprite anymore, and call getViewport. This will get us the closest viewport from this node, which is the screen itself. And we can call getViewport.getTexture.getImage.savePNG. And let's save this one as screen.png. And when we run the game now, our image is not there. We got a black image instead. That is because the screen is not ready. It didn't finish rendering its first image yet. So you'd think that awaiting a single frame would work. But this also doesn't work. If we set it to wait 2 frames though, it most likely would work. And we get our image. But that's kinda bad. The correct thing to do here is to await the rendering server.pauseFrameDraw. This will stop the code from running until the screen frame is actually drawn. And now, we properly got our image. But as you might have noticed, our image still doesn't have transparency. It just took the screen background color. To fix that, go to Project Settings, and if you search for Transparent, you can enable Transparent Background inside the Viewport tab. If you run the game now, the screen background will be black. But in the saved image, it is actually transparent. Now you can use Godot as an image exporter of sorts. But more useful than that is taking images from shader results. Let's take our planet and add a new shader material. Create a shader file, and I use a dissolve shader from Godot shaders here. For this specific shader to work, we need to create a noise texture, and inside that, create a new noise fast light. Now you just need to play around with the values until we get something you like. Change the burn color, the width, and the direction. And let's say we want to save this as an image. Maybe use it inside another program, or maybe feed it into another shader. Let's try the same steps as before. We'll drag our planet into the sprite slot, and inside the code, we'll re-add a sprite saving line, and save this one as planet.png. Run the game, and it didn't work. We got the original planet texture instead. It did not even have the light effects applied to it. So to solve this and unlock a whole new world of possible effects, you need to learn about subviewports. Let's start by adding a subviewport node to the scene. 2D subviewports essentially will take the objects inside it and render them into an image. So if we drag our planet inside, it will disappear from the scene. But when we select the subviewport, we can see it's in there in the inspector preview. In this case, the planets just so happen to be in the right position and size. But a subviewport will render things based on the size you set. And let's make sure we enable transparent background. If we try to add our small planet, you'll see that it is not there. That's because its position is outside of the subviewport image. If we increase the width, we can finally see our little planet. But that is not how you typically work with subviewports. So let's see another example. I'll put the planet inside it, and we can see it's in there. But the most important setting of a subviewport is inside its render target, the update mode. By default, this value is set to when visible, meaning the viewport will only render the image when it is visible. But as you might have noticed, the viewport doesn't have a visibility toggle. So what gives? Well, what this actually means is that it is visible when its parent is a subviewport container node or there is a subviewport texture that uses it. And that is the typical way most people are going to use subviewports. So let's reparent this to a subviewport container. This will immediately make the invisible children appear on the screen, because the subviewport container is rendering the image and showing it for you. And this will allow you to click and move objects inside it, that you couldn't do before. Another thing you can do is put a camera 2D inside the subviewport, and it will render the image based on the camera, just like adding a camera to your game changes the view. But if we put a camera 2D in the same position as the planet, and reduce the size of the viewport, we still see an empty image, and that is because the inspector display doesn't use the camera. But inside the game, it does, and we see the planet. So keep that in mind in case something strange is happening and you don't know why. We can move the container's position, and the whole image will move with it. So subviewports, while extremely powerful, are very easy to get confused with. It's important to know how they work. But let's go back to our scene. We are going to use a subviewport to save our image. This way, we can take a copy of the image after it has been affected by shaders and light effects. First, let's set the update mode to always, as we won't be using the subviewport container, but controlling it manually ourselves. And the update mode here sometimes changes by itself when moving the viewport node around, as Godot tries to guess what you want, so always check its actual value when moving this node around. Now let's add a camera 2D to it, drag the subviewport node inside the exporter node, and add our planet 8. Inside the code, you need the reference for the subviewport. And let's also set the sprite to the planet 8. Now all we need to do is to adjust the size of the viewport to match the sprites. So we use the viewport.size equals sprite.getRect.size and set the camera's position to the sprite's global position. If you have custom offsets in your sprites, you might need to subtract them here too. Then, after the frame post draw, we'll take the subviewport texture image and save that to planet.png. But our planet is not quite right, and that is because we also need to take into account the sprite's scale by multiplying it to the size. And there you go! Our modified planet is there saved to its own image. You can take it into the game and use it in any way you want. Now, another important thing to understand about subviewports is what words are. The reason they only draw children nodes is that a subviewport creates its own word 2D, and only its children nodes belongs to it, so it can see the nodes that live inside the game's word 2D. But let's say you want to save the image of the planet with the background, and I don't want to keep moving them in and out of the subviewport every time. What we can do in this case is make the subviewport share the same word 2D as the game. And while this doesn't show in the inspector, we can do that from code. You can do that with subviewport.word2d equals getViewport.word2d. And now we get the image of that section of the world. And of course, we can add transparency to the background, and that will also be there in the final image. Now that we got the basics done, let's see some extras and improvements we can do. So far, we have been using the update mode always, wasting performance each frame by rendering this image, even when we are not using it. Instead, let's set this to disable, which will not render any images. And then inside the code, when we need this rendered, we change the update mode to once. This will update the texture one time and set it to disabled again. This way, we only render the image when we need to. Everything still works the same. And here's another useful example. Take a look at this shader. It wobbles the image and is working great. But when we apply the same shader to our night sprite, something very strange is happening. The pixels at the borders stretches instead of wobbling inwards. So for this shader to work, we need a 1 pixel transparent border. Luckily, our exporter can do that very easily. Let's put it inside the photo viewport. Drag the sprite into the slot. And we just need to change the sprite rect with .grow1. This will expand the sprite's rect by 1 pixel all around. And now, the sprite has a nice little transparent border. In replacing the sprite, now the shader suddenly works. No more stretching borders. And finally, Godot has a very powerful noise texture. And with this new tool we made, now we can craft interesting noise maps and render them into images. The noise texture node even has the ability to add color maps to them, coloring the noise map into interesting shapes. And we can create some very interesting textures with it, with very little effort. Lastly, I've refactored the code a bit to give it more flexibility. Here's the final code. But that's it. Viewports are a very powerful tool to extract images and do all sorts of effects. As always, you can get the product files and experience if you'd like to support me on Patreon. I hope you liked this video, and until next time.